Hey folks, it's Frithgar here. How you doing? I have finished planting that field there, and we are now working on this field right here, and that's it. That'll be all of our corn planted. The field over there has now started growing as field 15, and if we take a look on the map, field 1 up there, that one should also have come up. See, part of field 15 and field 1 have now gone into the first growth stage. We don't need to worry about doing anything to them, however, because they've all got plenty of fertilizer on them. Before I go any further, my weekly question this week, I'm going to be doing silage for all of this corn that we've got here. We'll be using the class Jaguar to be doing the silage with. We've got our big cramper trailer down there that we'll be using to tow in the field. How would you like me to pull that trailer in the field? I'll be using the Tatra Phoenix truck to go between field and biogas plant, but do you want me to use the truck to tow the trailer in the field, like they do in, I believe it's more common in the States and Australia than it is in most other places, but it is done. So do you want me to use the truck to tow the trailer in the field? Do you want me to put the trailer onto a dolly once I get it to the field and use this Valtra to tow it up and down beside the class Jaguar? Or would you like me to put the dolly on the back of the forager and use the forager itself to tow its own trailer up and down the field? It's your vote, it's your game. Head into the comment section down below, let us know which one you want. And of course, don't forget to actually cast your vote by mousing over in the top right-hand corner. Now, if you notice in the top left-hand corner, you will see that there are a whole load of numbers and various bits of information. That is because I have just installed the Glance mod, and the way this one works is if you press Alt and M, minimum notification level, it changes it. So if we go right down to zero, that'll show us everything that we got on there. That's all of our machines and what they're doing and what the current state of them is and so on. So although I'm not sure what dirt 100% is, I'm not really sure what the dirt bit is all about in yellow there. It's difficult to see unless you sort of keep it over a dark area like this. So cow's milk, we've got 19,496, water at 24% for the sheep, and grass at 17%. And what it does is it shows you various different things when they get below certain levels. So it shows us the level of the milk tank, and it shows us that the water and the hay and grass are low. Sheep, grass, cow's milk. I'm assuming that it will show us more if other things turn up. Keeps telling us that Lely Juno is blocked, although I'm not sure why it's saying it is blocked. I don't know about that. Because it hasn't been blocked. I think it's just where it changes direction. It'll sort of come up with that. And so yeah, anyway, there we go. We've got the Glance mod so that we can use it if we want to. And then if you press the left Alt button and L, it increases the notification level, and you can go up through and reduce the number of things that you can see. If you go all the way up to 8, it gets rid of it completely, so you don't have all these numbers flashing up constantly. So if we want to use it, it's there, we can use it. If we don't, we don't have to. One other thing about it, if we come all the way back down here, if you press F1, it'll get rid of it. You just keep your ordinary help screen up there. And so if we go now, we can change it up through, and then I go like that. Yeah, see, it does show you, and then that bit will disappear as well. I'm actually pointing at the screen again. I do this a lot. I keep pointing at the screen every now and then. So anyway, I've got that set on 8, so we don't see any notifications, and we got the help turned off at the moment. So I've got another mod that I wanted to show you today, and we're going to leave hired help C going over there in that field, and we are going to head over to the what do you call the dealership. I was just thinking the selling place. What's the selling place called? It's the dealership. We're going to the dealership. I've got the class, not the class, I've got the Challenger over there waiting for us, and there's a new mob that we're going to lease and try out. Right, there is our Challenger ready and waiting. We've got the bale spike, the bucket, and the bale squeeze here for when we want to come up and get them. We bought a bag of fertilizer. I haven't actually needed to use that one at all, so I don't need to worry about that one. But anyway, we want to come here and we want to get this mod here. Now, this one is only just recently turned up in the mod hub, and it's a forestry-related item. And yes, I'm going to do a little bit of forestry today. I'm not going to do the big forestry operation that we were talking about previously, but I figured that we need to... So it's this one here. This just goes on a three-point linkage, and it's for picking up a single log. We might be able to get two logs with it. I don't know. So yes, we are going to be doing our forestry at some point, a big forestry operation. However, I'm not going to be doing that today. I just wanted to do something to while away the time between planting our corn and harvesting it next week. So we're going to take a look at this mod, see what it's all about. And tomorrow, I'm not quite sure what we're going to do, but we'll probably find another unusual mod and we'll take a look at that as well. So you can lower it up and down like that. Let's just bring the help up here a minute. So we can lower it up and down like that. And if we... I see. Right. Let's just zoom in a little bit. You can move it that way, forwards and back. Now, how is that working? It is clipping a little bit. We're getting a little bit of clipping there. So you can move... That's pressing the mouse button and moving it sideways. And then you can press the mouse button and move it up and down. And that... basically, you can move your three-point linkage. You can lift the tractor off the ground with it as well. So it does reach down quite effectively. I'm trying to lower it down as much as I can whilst keeping it sort of up as much as possible as well. It's not easy to do this. Right, let's lift that one right up as much as we can. There we go. We'll put it there so it's not clipping anything. And then you've got the two mouse buttons together, which is for doing that, which we just pick up a log with. Okay, all looks good. Fairly straightforward. Let's get rid of that. And we're going to head up to the sawmill, and we're going to do a bit of work up there. I don't really want to be dragging the logs a long way because this tractor is painfully slow, as most of you already know. So I figured that it would be quite good. All right, let's zip across the road in front of that one. I figured it'd be quite good to go up there beside the sawmill and try and pick up a couple of trees and move them. I'm not sure which trees we'll do yet, but we'll find something up there and chop it down and see if we can drag it around. We'll do a pine tree or two, and then if there's a different type of tree, whatever type that we've got up there, we'll try one of those as well, see if we can drag that over to the sell point and or into the mill pond. I'm not really sure which trees we'll do. I mean, there's a few trees sort of scattered around here. There's a stand of trees just back there. Or we could try doing a bit of mountaineering with the tractor. I mean, this tractor would actually be perfect for climbing up the hills there. But what I am looking around for is any other kinds of trees. It doesn't look like there's any here. This is predominantly pine trees in this valley anyway. Really doesn't look like there's any others. Turn all of our flashing beacons and lights and everything off a second. And I'm going to get rid of the map. There we go. Right, I think that we're going to try and climb up the mountain with this tractor, and we're going to get one of those trees up there. So let's scramble up there first. This thing is a beast of a tractor. And, right, so for those of you who've driven these things in real life, you've told me that the handling is not ideal compared to other tractors. What are they like for stability? Because I get the impression from just scrambling up here that stability is something that is hugely in this tractor's favour. You look at the tractor, you look at the profile of it, it's quite wide and it's squat, it's lower to the ground than a regular tractor. So with all that weight being right low down, I would say my personal estimate from using other machinery, climbing up there would not be an unrealistic challenge for the Challenger. I would say that that is something that you can reasonably expect it to do. So for that reason, I'm going to do it, obviously. I've already done it. I do like to try and make sure that we get everything as realistic as possible on this channel. It doesn't necessarily mean we will always get things as realistic as possible, but for those of you with real life experience, let me know what those things are like with stability. I really would like to know that one. Just because if it's as stable as I think it is, I mean, it looks like it is. It would be perfect for like doing like mountain logging and stuff. It'd be absolutely spot on for it. So we that's actually worth remembering in the future. If we got some like really difficult to get to places, definitely worth sort of keeping in mind for the future. That one hasn't fallen over, but what I'm thinking is, oop, this one's rolling down the hill towards us. Is that just going to... Oh, no, it's stuck up against that tree there. We'll chop that one down in a minute. I'm going to chop that one down as well. Now, let's clear this tree here of branches. If I can. Now, I don't want to cut it. Right, I think I've got most of the branches off of that one. There. And we'll cut this one down as well and take the branches off of it. There's an extra branch on there that I have missed so far. Oh, there we go, got it. And we'll chop that one down, and then we'll drag them down. I'm going to try reversing one into the pond. I don't know. I know that we used to get a price penalty if you dropped it into the pond, but I'm not sure that you do anymore. I really don't know. So we'll take a look, see how it compares dropping it in the pond to the other point. I do know for a fact now that... dropping a whole tree, you actually get less for the tree as a whole than you do if you cut it into reasonable lengths. And reasonable lengths, 8 meters seems to be the optimum length of cutting up the branches. If you have it longer than 8 meters or shorter than 8 meters, you get penalized for it, whereas if you can do it exactly 8 meters, it's spot on. I am, however, going to do these just as they are, because I don't want to risk them running down the hill and going into the lake and us not getting paid for them. I'm not actually sure where the sell point is. I think it's those boards that are down there. Now let's back up to this tree here. Shove it over. There we go. Timber! Right. And, right, well, let's get that solid one, the cleaned one, rather, first. Back up here and sort of straddle the log like that and then come a bit further forward. There, I reckon about like that would be ideal. So let's first I want to open it, then lower down. Let's try that, and then I'm putting the two mouse buttons together. Right, that's not actually picking it up properly, though, is it? Oh, I see. You push it right up to the plate, and then it lifts the log off the ground. Ingenious. Right, let's lower it down and open up those teeth again. So how do you do this? Oh, you sort of push the plate. You lift it like that so that the plate comes further forward. Then you move... further back like that. Right, so I've just touched the plate. I'm going to inch forward a little tiny bit, but if you look there, you can see those teeth. I think those are for actually helping you to hold on to the thing. So you grab it like that and lift, then you lift it up in the air like that. It sits up against the plate, and I reckon you could probably take more than one log, but we'll hold it like that. Because I thought to start with that this thing grabbed it, but it doesn't. This thing... Can you move... You can't move it. You can't swing it side to side. All you've got is this option here. So it doesn't swivel. So let's see what it's like climbing back down this cliff. We want to go easy. Brakes on full. It's just slid to the side. It's now destroying my tracks on my tractor. This is not the way forward. I didn't want to do this. This is not the way to treat your machine. But let's bring it over here and round this way. There we go. So I've sold one. 594. Not a huge amount. And we'll back up the hill this time. Bring it out this way. Take a good look at this machine. Back right up the hill. So I want to try and get that one that we haven't trimmed. I'm thinking that if we could get in a slightly different position, we'd have a better chance of getting some a couple of trees together. It might work better if we had two or three trees. Let's just open that one up and lower it right down. Close it together. Lift it right up. Right, it does seem to work all right. So I mean, this tree is definitely a bit smaller than the last one that we got, but I am hoping that it will... Well, see, this is the thing. We don't know just how much difference it's going to be. I'm just trying to see how much money we get for it. Again, it's slipped to the side. It does seem to be very easy to slip to the side. Is there any other options for it? You've got the GPS, cruise control, tension belts. Oh, you're kidding me. We got tension belts on it. That's what we need to be using. Right, we've got tension belts. Tension belts make a huge difference to how we do things. So let's bring this one over here and see what we get for selling it. 275. Not a great deal, but that's okay. Let's get back up the hill. This time we're going to get that great big log over there. So we want to go steady up this little bit. This is a bit you've got to go the steadiest, but I do think if you look at the angles that that thing is when it's sitting on the hill and everything, there is no point at no point do you think it's going to tip over. And for those of you who don't know, let me just show you. I'll just jump out here a minute. When you look at a machine, right, it has a center of gravity, and when it's upright, the center of gravity runs right down through the middle. Yeah? Now what you need to do is you actually need to find the center point of the weight on the machine. So the center point of the weight on this machine, not the top of the machine, but the center point of the weight, because it's got all of these weights and the really heavy chassis and everything, the engine and that, I would say that the center point for the weight of this tractor is about here, right? Now, in order for this tractor to tip over, that center point of the weight has got to move out over the edge of those tracks. So when it's on a steep hill, you have a look at it, and if that center point is just coming out to there, it's on very steep ground, and it's, you know, it's pushing it as it's coming out there, it's near the edge of the tracks, but it's still stable, it's still going to sit there. It's only when that center point of the weight goes past the outside edge that your tractor will tip over. And that's the same for any load anywhere at all. So if we just come out here, and I'm going to put this one right on the slope here, so we will come back out again, and now if we have a look, you have a look. So I'm guessing still the center point of our weight on this machine is there, and if we go straight down, not even close to tipping point, not even close, it's on the inside edge of those tracks. Now, because the track's rubber, you'd want to play it safe, and you wouldn't really want it to go past that point there, but we're still weighing, we're like in here. So this tractor does appear to me, unless I've got my guess for where the center point of the actual weight of the machine is, unless I got that completely wrong, I would say this tractor is spectacularly stable on any steep slope. So even though it's painfully slow and the steering is horribly over responsive, or at least compared to what I'm used to, I would say that this tractor has got some serious merit in the fact that appears to be a lot harder to tip over than any other tractor that I have driven. And I would say that is a huge bonus point for it. Now let's put that strap on there. Is that really... Oh, it pushes it down a little bit. I see. Right, so that should hold its... Oh, I see. We're up against a tree up there. Wrong way. I want to come out that way like that. So it's sort of holding the strap in place like that. I'm going to leap out a second and take off some of these branches here. Like that. I want to get this clean, this log. Now, I haven't actually... I apologize for spending so long talking about the center of gravity on this thing. I hope you don't mind. I really wanted to just sort of explain that one to you. Right. This is okay, the whole strap thing, but I don't like the way it's swinging around like that. So I would say that, yes, it's good, but it does lose a few points because of the way that it's swinging like that. And let's come forward a bit, and we'll drop this one here. If I take these straps off now, drop that down. Right, so it basically pushed this the log outside of the area of the grab with the strap, and then when you release the strap, it could just kind of drop the whole thing. Didn't like that. Let's lower it down. Now what we're going to do is we're going to cut this one in half and see what it's like for picking up two. I know eight meter logs would actually be probably cutting this one into three pieces, but I think we'll just try it with two, and we'll drop it over the sell point then and see how it goes. Right. There's two of them. So let's pick this first one up. We want to lower it down. Close that grab. And lift him up in the air. And then I will come back up like this. And set it down. I don't want to do it too... Ooh, Helper C has completed their task. In theory, that should be all the rest of our corn planted. So let's open that one wide out. Now, of course, we've got the issue that we need to try and get both of these logs in together. And how successful is this going to be? The other thing that we can try, of course, is putting the straps on without closing the grab. Although I'm not, that kind of defeats the purpose as far as I'm concerned. You ought to be using the grab. And if we do that... Sorry, I'm whizzing the camera around an awful lot today. So if we do it like that, it is picking them up. But I don't really like the way that it does it with the straps on this one. It kind of feels like it's not really working properly. Whoa! Okay, okay. Easy, easy. Calm yourself. Right, it really doesn't seem to like doing the doing the two together. Really didn't seem to like that, did it? Not at all. Right, there we go. We've got this huge, great big log grab. We've got two logs out the back. And are we going to sell them here or should we go and drop them in the water? Let's sell these two here. We'll see how that gets on. I'm loving this thing. I am actually, I am quite liking it. It's horribly awkward to use and it's difficult. Right, 1,942 plus 800. So we have about 2,800 there. That's not bad. That's not bad. I mean, obviously it could be a lot better, but I think, you know, we... Beggars can't be choosers, and at the moment we're kind of on beggar status. We don't have a huge amount of cash. Let's scramble ourselves back up here. Over we go. Let's see if the tipping point... See, even there, you look at that. You look at the center. I mean, even if you take the very top of the machine and you put the top of the cab in a straight line down, that is still inside the level of those tracks. So... Even if you take the tipping point as being the very highest point on the tractor rather than the center of gravity of the load, it's still stable. It's still not going anywhere at all, which is absolutely fantastic. Very, very solid machine, or very stable machine, I should say. Right, let's bring this one down and chop through there. So we've paid for the claw grab that we've got. That's paid for itself. That would only cost us a couple hundred dollars, didn't it? Now, can I? I don't think you can. We're just going to have to push it over with the tractor. We got a massive front weight on the front. Let's just do this the old-fashioned way and ram it. There we go. No, no, no! Okay, that's that was close. That's why, ladies and gentlemen, you don't ram a tree with your tractor. Because if you do ram a tree with your tractor, you can very easily end up having the tree topple down right on top of your cab. Not a fun way to do things. Now, if we go get it just lined up just right there. Whiz up through, taking off all of those branches. I think that's every single one. Look at that. Polished clean. Clean as a whistle. A couple more down through there on that side. And because I've chopped them all off, it's now going to move a lot easier. So I want to get this end of it. And this time, stop moving. Where's it going? It's going to wind up right down the bottom, isn't it? That's where it's headed. I was kind of hoping it wouldn't do that. Right, this time we're going to try and dump it into the water. We'll chop it in half again because I think that one's roughly the same size as the last one. Obviously, you can't get a true comparison unless you reload the game and load up the same tree and do it to the same tree. But I think we can get a fair comparison just by doing it like this. So we're going to try and grab that tree. We're going to have to back at it like this. If I can pull it like that and then grab. There we go. Right, I'm going to put the strap on this time, like that. Open that a little bit, because the strap is actually helping to hold it. It does help to hold it in place, which is good. okay, that's slightly ridiculous. Yeah, and also the weight going back down here. This is probably going to pull our tractor over. So let's just let it run with it. Don't try and press the brakes. Let it run, let it run. And that's sometimes what you've got to do. The way to deal with a hill, with a steep hill, is instead of trying to stop yourself, instead of trying to save yourself from, you know, and putting your brakes on and everything like that, you don't put your brakes on. You don't try and stop yourself. You just steer yourself in a straight line, straight down towards where it starts to level out again. And then, after you've reached the bottom, then you can sort of stop and you can reposition yourself. But while you're on the hill, applying the brakes can be extremely dangerous. This can be one of the most dangerous things that you can do. If you're working, especially with a smaller tractor that's got a larger weight on it, if you find yourself running down a hill, applying a brake could be about the most dangerous thing you can do. And a lot of times, people having accidents on hills, on steep hills, they don't have the accident because the steep hill tipped them over. They have the accident because they put brakes on whilst on the steep hill. And I know it sounds a little bit odd, especially for those people who aren't used to doing a lot of doing work on steep ground. But yeah, it's one of the most dangerous things. Working on steep ground can be putting your brakes on. And those of you who do work a lot on steep ground are probably quite familiar with this. When I learned to drive tractors, I learned to drive much older tractors. My father is the one that taught me how to first drive a tractor. And the first thing that he ever told me was, you learn to drive a tractor that has no frills and spills whatsoever. It doesn't have anything extra, doesn't have, not even four-wheel drive, right? I had is an old two-wheel drive Massey Ferguson 35, and he said, if you learn to drive one of those tractors, when you come to driving the really cool tractors with all the frills and spills and all the extra bits, it's a lot easier. Easy. It's considerably easier when you come to do that, right? I see. It's vibrated the log a long way. Yeah, it's basically sort of shaken that one all the way up close. We don't really want to do that. So let's see if we can pick that one up. I'm going to lower the plate down. And I'm going to back my way up to the... there we go. So we'll pick them both up. We come forward just a fraction. And now I'll try to pick them up. But we don't want to squeeze them too tight because they start shaking around like crazy. I think that's probably enough. Pick them up like that. There we go. Hopefully that will hold. I'm going to try and do this without using the straps. I want to get past this sell point so that I can tip these into the pond. So yeah, I learned to drive on small old tractors, and it wasn't until after I'd learned to drive those that I then started driving all sorts of other machinery. And you know, you can transfer the skills across quite easily, quite well. And I think those skills that I learned driving those small tractors have really served me well. And that's one thing that I always remembered. Was I learned to drive, right, what did we get there? That's pretty much exactly the same as we got for the last tree. So it doesn't appear to be a great deal of difference between the two. I don't really want to cut down any more trees now and do that, so we're going to head back to the dealership and return this one. While we're on our way back, my question for this week, we're going to be doing silage very, very soon, next week I'm hoping, and we're going to be using the cramper trailer in the field. We'll run it backwards and forwards. On the way to the biogas plant, we will use the Tatra Phoenix truck to tow the trailer back to the biogas plant. We'll tip it out there and then bring it back to the field. But when we're in the field, how would you like me to tow the trailer up and down the field? Would you like me to just leave it on the Tatra Phoenix truck and tow it up and down the field with the truck like they do in... I believe it's more common in the States and Australia than it is in other countries, but it is done around the world in different places. Would you like me to unhitch the trailer beside the field and not drive on the field with the truck? Instead, swap over and tow it with the Valtra tractor and using a dolly. So we tow it beside the forager with the tractor. Or would you like me to put a dolly on the back of the forager and have the forager tow its own trailer? Now, that's a lot less common anywhere in the world, but it is still done in places. So it's your vote. It's your game. Head in the comment section down below. Let us know which one you want. And of course, don't forget to actually cast your vote by mousing over in the top right-hand corner. Today's topic of conversation, what I'd really like to hear, other than about the stability of the Challenger or other tractors like it, for those of you who have learned to drive, whether it's cars or tractors or anything else, tell me how you learnt to drive. What was it that sort of, you know, anything particularly special about when you learnt to drive? Because everybody's got different stories about how they learnt, you know, different tips and so on that the person who was teaching them taught them. My main tip that I had was learn to drive the old machinery first, and then after you've mastered the old machinery, the new machinery becomes a lot easier to handle. And I also learned on a combination of flat and steep ground, and I can remember seeing this little Massey 35. Let's just return that one. We're not going to be using that one anymore now. I'm going to start driving back. I remember seeing this little Massey 35 going down a really steep hill with a granite roller on the back. And the roller, the estimated weight of that roller must have been close to a ton. It was one of the biggest granite rollers for 30 miles in any direction. It was a point of pride of my grandfather when it first turned up at his farm, was that it was one of the biggest granite rollers that had been made in the area. And he'd always been extremely proud of that roller. So that's the one that we held on the back of this tiny little Massey. And going around most of the field, it was fine. You couldn't go up the steep hills with that roller. The tractor just couldn't pull it up the hill. So you went down the hill. And sometimes it was all right. It just kind of made the tractor rev a little bit. And other times it would really start to go. And then it would start to slide. One or the other of the wheels would actually start to slip. If it was over a particularly steep bit, or you hit a bit of mud or something, one of the wheels would start to slip. Now, if you did nothing, you would very easily, the tractor would twist as it slipped, and you would end up tipping it over with a one-ton roller landing on top of you, which is not the way to go. So what you would do is you would push the accelerator. Now, you didn't have an accelerator pedal on those tractors. It was just on the console, on like the dashboard bit in front of you. You rev that one up really hard, and revved and accelerated down the hill so that the wheels would dig in again, and then you'd ease back on the throttle, bring it back under control. And I remember watching my dad do this several times as he was going around the field, and he'd come down the steepest bit, and he would, you know, oftentimes you'd have to do that on the really steep bits, rev it, bring it back under control, rev it again, bring it back under control, and get down to the bottom, do it safely. And then he made me get on the tractor and he made me do it, right? And no, he wasn't just being sadistic and horrible, and he wasn't trying to put me in a situation that was extremely dangerous. He was trying to make sure that he basically was setting up a controlled environment for something extremely dangerous. A tractor driver needs to know how to handle their machine when it's going out of control. So he put me in a situation where it was beginning to go out of control. While he was with me, he knew how to bring it under control himself and made certain that I could do it myself. And I was 14 when I learned to do this. And that has served me well. I have had a number of occasions when I've been working steep ground with a machine where that knowledge of how to do it, and knowing that I've already done it, so knowing that I've experienced this in the past and I've done it, and I have already successfully brought the machine under control and I haven't been hurt, no one else has been hurt either, the whole thing was successful. So I know that I can do that. And that is how I learned to drive a tractor, was basically being put in a situation that could potentially kill someone. And people have been killed through that kind of experience. And learning how to deal with it safely and efficiently. And that is, so I've always remembered that. Just because it's dangerous doesn't mean you can't do something safely. And it's knowing how to deal with a dangerous situation and learning how to deal with a dangerous situation is far more valuable than just avoiding a dangerous situation altogether. So since then, I've always relished the challenge of working any vehicle on steep ground. Any kind of farm work on steep ground has always appealed to me because it's so much more of a challenge. You've got so many more things that you've got to assess and deal with as you're doing the job. So just flat ground is, you know, relatively simple. You can do it and carry on. But when you start getting onto steep ground, that's where I've always enjoyed. I've always found it far more interesting to work steep ground than I have to work just flat fields. I've always loved that challenge because you know that it's much more dangerous. You know that there's so many more things that could go wrong, and so yeah, well, I guess it's kind of thrill-seeking, really, isn't it? But at the same time, it's a satisfaction of knowing that you can do something that it's extremely difficult and potentially very dangerous, and that's something I've always enjoyed. But anyway, enough about that. How did I start on this? Oh yeah, we were looking at the Challenger on a steep ground, weren't we? So yeah, I probably have run way over time yet again. I keep doing this. If you've enjoyed this episode, then please head down below and give us a like. And if you really enjoyed it, please tell your friends all about me. Get them to come and watch as well. That would be awesome. I'm going to watch the sunset. And until next time, thank you very much for watching. This is Frithgar. Goodbye and see you later.